Welcome to Incognito, the podcast. I'm your host, Michael Fosberg, and I am very happy to have you along for the third season of the show. This season, we continue to delve into rich conversations with guests from a variety of fields and backgrounds to discover how they go about creating and maintaining an inclusive workspace or community. As I have expressed both during seasons one and two, I am thoroughly enjoying these dialogues, and of course, I'm hoping you are as well. Guests have been sharing such wonderful ideas and methods and practices that can help uplift and create unity. And I'm going to talk more on that later in the show. But for today's podcast, I'll be once again flying solo as I try to address a couple of topics. First and foremost is, why this podcast? What's the point? Yet another podcast that features interviews with interesting but random guests. Why should people listen? Now, these are not necessarily questions I've been asked by listeners, but really questions I continue to ask myself. In the age of the podcast, and with what I've read is an estimated to be well over 800,000 podcasts out there, why listen to this one? If I am encouraging you, the listener, to commit some of your already precious time to listen to this podcast, especially in a market that is probably well oversaturated with interview shows, why listen to this one? And why listen to a guy who pretty much asks the same questions of each of his guests? Okay, well, let me tackle these self-generated questions with a little background on the genesis of this podcast. So I originally set out to produce and host a podcast in early 2018. I had a vague idea about having conversations with guests that revolved around the topic of commonalities. For those of you who are regular listeners to this podcast, you know that I'm constantly preaching about how we have more in common than different, and this is a big, big focus of my work. Initially, however, I felt that I needed a co-host to be able to bounce ideas and thoughts off of, and to help make for more robust conversations with guests. I enlisted the help of a new friend in the DE&I, Diversity, Equity, Inclusion space, who held down a pretty big job with a large corporation here in Chicago. We'd always had engaging conversations when we got together, and so I thought, you know, we could make a good on-air team. Although not a natural public speaker, nor having any radio interviewing experience, she seemed up for the challenge. So after conducting some research on how to go about crafting a professional podcast, looking into microphones, audio software, editing, and other related podcast necessities, we stumbled through a couple of clumsy attempts to record what we were calling our introduction stories. However, once we listened to those early attempts, it became obvious we needed some production assistance. I wanted the podcast to sound and feel professionally produced and was really unclear what that would necessitate. I began to seek out assistance, and after much cajoling, I was able to twist the arms of two friends, one who had done some producing and was connected to public radio, and a second friend possessing professional sound engineering skills. As we embarked on the podcast project with the working title of Common Denominator, we very soon discovered the strain of our respective work schedules. My co-host and the producer each had big full-time jobs, and the sound engineer and I both traveled quite a bit for work. So this made finding times not only to meet and discuss the shape of the project, but also time to record quite challenging. After months of trying to sort through schedules, find studio time, and then match guests with their ability to connect, we attempted a studio recording. At the time, it felt fairly robust and engaging, but when the engineer and I sat listening to the recording and made attempts to edit it, it soon became clear it was kind of a mess. A second attempt at a redo more than a month later, after once again marrying all the various schedules of folks involved, was equally chaotic and jumbled. It felt, I mean, if you'll excuse the expression, as if we were trying to fit a square peg into a round hole. It just wasn't a good fit. After conferring with the team again due to scheduling conflicts several months later, we decided to abandon the project. At the time, I felt okay with making the decision to terminate since it truly was not reflective of what I had hoped we'd be able to contribute to the podcast space. But I guess in retrospect, I was actually a bit depressed over what I perceived to be a failure. And I couldn't stop thinking about what it was I really wanted to contribute to this space. In early spring in 2022, I was still struggling to regain business following the loss of in-person presentations due to the pandemic. As some businesses began to return to their offices, and I was securing a few random bookings across the country, I became hyper-aware of how people responded to Incognito. The play and subsequent dialogue have always been very well received, resulting in terrific feedback and positive word of mouth to other prospective clients, quite often leading to more work. But over time, I encountered a couple of deficiencies, or let's call them limitations, to my work. First was that the 90 minutes corporations spent with me tackling issues of DE&I were not an end unto itself. More work needed to be done, and although for some companies that 90 minutes was all they were willing to commit, others had robust strategies in place, and mine was but a small fraction of their plan. Second, I found upon leaving a place that I was no longer engaged in the conversation. I wanted to find a way to continue the work, the conversations, the shift in the way people viewed and talked about race and identity. In other words, I wanted to continue to offer additional learning even after I was gone. I didn't want it to be a one and done kind of thing. Thus, I was able to craft this iteration of the podcast as a way to impart more tools, practices, and methods for people to use to engage in more authentic and meaningful conversations. It became clear to me after 20 years of traveling across the country doing this work that I was constantly witnessing people doing DEI work, but these were not necessarily DEI professionals. They simply called it their jobs. I wanted to learn how they went about creating inclusive workplaces and communities so I could share their secrets with listeners and thus continue to do the work I set out to do in performing Incognito. So, this podcast exists to offer you tools, methods, practices, ideas, and thoughts about how to craft a more inclusive environment at your workplace or in your community. Every episode, each guest offers their secret, or perhaps not so secret, ways in which they have been able to collaborate inclusively within their fields or disciplines. And in order to discover how various leaders across a wide spectrum of fields go about creating inclusivity in their workspace, uniting their staffs, and inspiring those around them to work together, I ask the same set of questions. A set of questions that gets us to the core of how they bring people together, help inspire, and lead. If you work with others, are a part of some community, or are simply looking for ways to improve relationships, this podcast is for you. In other words, it's for everyone who comes in contact with other people. There's something here for all of us to use and learn from. And this is where I would like to highlight some of those terrific practices people use. Documentarian Kirsten Kelly from Season 1, Episode 1 offered, "Come with your armor down." So what does that mean? How about not showing up ready to defend or offend? Practice intentional curiosity. Be curious always. Play, she said. And that just makes me think of play and play and play and play. If you can't seem to wrap your arms around play, remember what it was like to play as a child. Like I always hated the stage directions often given by directors to stage actors to have fun. But, well, I'm urging you, as is Kirsten, to have fun, play. Jason Lavasser, with his infectious energy, offered, "Be interested, not interesting." Enough said. Coach and healer Julie Daly suggested, "We must allow people to be heard and felt." She offered to extend an invitation, be welcoming. Monty Sciro offered years of practical experience in the restaurant business by suggesting, "Nobody does it alone." And you can't say you care and not act like it, or as I like to say, walk the talk. He also suggested, seek to understand before being understood. Scott Lanham, a trusted government administrator, offered some advice by suggesting, work is about service, about helping people. He encouraged people to build relationships, and one of my favorites, he said, "Vulnerability is a strength." Steve Edwards, former journalist and radio host, says, "Try to find the connections to shared human experiences and ask yourself, am I learning? Am I listening?" Storyteller Willa Taylor suggested to find ways to interrupt the assumptions. Share stories and allow yourself to be changed by them. Ask what is needed. And of course, share great food. Investment strategist Quinton Alston Spratt said, "Don't take things personally. Be intentional, approaching with purpose. Create safety, remove titles and judgments." Meditator actor Jeff Kober wisely offered, "Look to give rather than get. Also, your opinions are the least interesting thing about you." Dean E. Patrick Johnson gently and forcefully made the case for expressing grace, leading with integrity, and he offered, "Practice radical listening with compassion, and recognize the value of people who serve others." Randy Ryan, gardener extraordinaire, said, "There is no better way to heal than to heal others. Get outside your community and expose yourself to other ideas and cultures." Theologian Jamie Price suggests, "Ask people what they need and how you can help. Reject the notion that we have to be polarized." Illinois Congressional Representative Teresa Ma insists we must be present and listen. Reach down to pull up others. Invite people to have space to contribute. Kimberly Naran suggests practice humility. Think of others first. Know you're not in competition with others. Appreciate people's time and seek out different perspectives. The quiet and ever so important Andre Watson from DHS emphatically offers, "Never ask someone to do something you haven't done or wouldn't be willing to do yourself." And, of course, he says, "We have more in common than not." And offers four tips: have patience, an open mind, willingness to listen, and seek support. Actor, director, creator Josie Whittlesey tells us, "Play is the best way to build trust." There's that play again. "Show up consistently. Be persistent." And restorative justice practitioner Bessie Alcantara suggests, "Offer honesty, be direct, and invite ownership. And look for shared values." These are but a small handful of methods, practices, thoughts, and ideas that successful leaders from a wide range of fields use in their daily work routines to bring people together and work more inclusively, efficiently, and successfully. If you are seeking to transform your workplace, your community, your relationships, these are a few places you can start. Again, thanks for listening to the podcast. Your support and listening is much appreciated. I am also always looking to hear what you think about the podcast, your suggestions for changes, different angles, new guests, and of course, we continue to look for sponsorship, and if you or someone you know, the company you work for, or others might have an interest in the positive messages and practical help and advice this show offers, we'd love to discuss how you or they might help us continue this work. We'll see you next week with another interesting guest. Thank you.